We went through a pretty difficult period, you know, from 2012 to 2017, 2016, and then we had a, you know, bit of a pause in 2017, 2018, and things resumed again in 2019. So, you know, being an investor in this space has not exactly been easy over the last, you know, 5, 6, 7 years. And as an executive team, you know, it's just as challenging, you know, because we put budgets together at certain metal prices and we anticipate, you know, getting those revenues into the door so we can make the necessary investments to expand the business. And when the metal prices don't perform, then we have to cut back our investments. And that often includes, you know, layoffs, or it could include canceling or postponing projects and all these kinds of things, a start and stop type of activity that the miners are forced into sometimes do add to costs because it's expensive to do that. So we have to try to remain conservative as best as possible in order not to, you know, go crazy on the CapEx side just because we see higher metal prices. Because even though, despite the fact that I think, you know, we're going to see triple digit silver, you know, we are running a, you know, large publicly traded company and it is our shareholders' money. So, you know, we have to be somewhat conservative when we're deploying capital. But, you know, we are expanding Santa Elena right now with the Ermitaño project coming online. There's investment going into exploration at San Dimas. And so we're very focused on resource development, life of mine expansion. And now with Jerritt Canyon coming into the picture, you know, same kind of strategy is going to be employed there. Well, first off, we're all humans, and you know, when price rises, greed rises. So, so it, you know, it takes two to tango. It takes two groups to say yes to a transaction, and then often, when you know prices are running, as we've seen that they've done over the last couple of years, you know, the sellers tend to shy away a little bit, and it's more challenging for the buyers to do deals. So, M&A transactions do definitely slow down. The other hindrance to M&A is, as I've said this before, is the lack of conferences, you know, mining conferences whereby, you know, the executives of all these mining companies are, you know, have a chance to see each other face to face and actually talk about, you know, deals and what things look like in the future. And that really helps or has helped historically M&A transactions. And without those conferences, I think that's also had a negative impact on M&A activity. Well, you know, everyone that's listening to this podcast or this interview knows, you know, my spiel and my bullish comments regarding the metal. You know, I look at silver as a strategic metal, not so much as a precious metal, despite the fact it is precious. You know, going to the precious story for a second, in 2020, for every 1 ounce of gold mined worldwide, there was only 7 ounces of silver mined, which is a pretty shocking number considering we're trading at something in the order of 70 to 1 in the financial markets. So that's just that. Now, on the pure demand side, you know, when it comes to whether it's the Green Deal or whether it's just the electrification of the planet or, you know, what have you, you know, you look at copper prices, you look at commodities, as silver is really the only commodity that's not really reaching its highs that it has reached now on two separate occasions back in 1980 and in 2011. I think we're going to see that high breached in this cycle. And when it does, it's going to wake up the market. And that's what I think it's, well, once it breaks through the $50 level, I think that it's going to get up to the $100 level pretty quickly. You know, it might bounce around 70 or 80. Who knows? But you know, I think those are the kinds of numbers. You know, copper broke through 10,000 a pound yesterday, and you know, oil's on its way back to $100 a barrel, and you know, we're getting into a pretty inflationary time. And also, you add the actual supply deficits on top of that with silver, you've got a perfect storm. You know, just in the making, in my opinion. If you go back 20 years and look at solar panels. Today, there's less silver being used in solar panels due to efficiencies in the technology. So, the, you know, the companies, who DuPonts, who produce this material for the solar panels, you know, have been able to reduce the amount of silver used, and also, you know, at the same time, have the same power density. There's a limit to that, and it's likely reached now. So whether the solar panel industry can actually reduce silver even further, there's a lot of doubt around that. You know, you could go to a very cheap solar panel, but the efficiencies are going to drop below 25%. And then the solar panel itself is almost uneconomic. So why even bother buying it in the first place? Other technologies like electric cars, you know, that's not going backwards. I think everyone listening to this would agree that the future is electric. And then probably after that, fuel cells, but that's probably 50 years on the road. But the next big move is going to be electric cars, and that's going to be a huge consumer of silver. Well, look, the guy that runs the CFTC just recently in an interview said they were successfully able to cap the market when it ran up to $30 an ounce. Pretty shocking statement from somebody who runs, the exchange. Nevertheless, so there is definitely efforts to keep these markets kind of at bay, whether it's the silver or gold market. And I'm a big believer in physical demand will ultimately break the strangleholds on these paper markets. And that's what I advocate people do, and I suggest people continue to do that. Well, silver prices, that's what we're talking about today, have been caught in this trading range for some 30 years. When I say trading range, I mean trading ratio. Mm-hmm. And you get used to that, and the banks get used to that. When it gets, at the top end of that range, they may decide to, take on a bigger position. When it gets on the lower side of that range, maybe they do some other trading. I don't work in the banks anymore, but I kind of know how things work. But when you're Sony or Tesla or Apple, and then you just given one of the banks a big order for silver, and you need it delivered to very various ports around the world for you to be able to manufacture your products, and all of a sudden one of the banks can't deliver to you. Because of the physical metals just simply not there, that's where I think we're headed. And I think it's going to be the retail investor who's going to cause the biggest issue for that event to occur, because we do have a new buyer in the market that wasn't there a couple of years ago. Since I put First Majestic together 19 years ago, there's been pretty much, the same buyer in this market. And the banks are pretty familiar with the commercial demand. They obviously monitor that pretty closely. What they don't monitor and can't control is their retail demand.